Those songs correct?
Okay, I've got different ones, but good thing I checked. They probably are, I've just probably screenshotted the wrong thing. Alright. Yeah, I screenshotted last week's rather than this week's, so. Ready. Okay. Well, good evening, everybody. It's a joy to be with you all this evening. Our God is the God who meets with us in his beautiful grace, the God who gives rest to the weary, comfort to those who mourn, strength to the weak, love to the unloved, and grace to sinners in Christ, meets with us, his people, here at church. So it's a joy to be with you all this evening. We'll get right into it with our call to worship. So if I could ask you to open your Bibles to Psalm 128. Psalm 128 is our call to worship for this evening. Psalm 128, a song of ascents, reading from verse 1. Blessed is everyone who fears the Lord, who walks in his ways. You shall eat the fruit of the labor of your hands. You shall be blessed, and it shall be well with you. Your wife will be like a fruitful vine within your house. Your children will be like olive shoots around your table. Behold, thus shall the man be blessed who fears the Lord. The Lord bless you from Zion. May you see the prosperity of Jerusalem all the days of your life. May you see your children's children. Peace be upon Israel. Let's respond now to the reading of God's word with a song. Let us sing together our first song for this evening. That song is hymn 104, Great is Thy Faithfulness. Pray together. Our gracious Heavenly Father, what a joy it is to be gathered here this evening. Indeed, to be gathered here by your grace this evening, to hear from you, to be shepherded by you, to be fed by you through the preaching of your word. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you that it is more precious than gold. It is more precious than jewels. It is sweeter than honey and drippings of the honeycomb. It is the most wonderful thing in the world. And Father, we pray that it would be sweet and precious and wonderful to us this evening. Father, your word contains many beauties. It contains beauties that testify to the glories of nature. We read in Psalm 19 that the heavens declare your glory, the sky above proclaims your handiwork. We see in your word the beauty of the gifts that it speaks of, the gifts of food and wine and fellowship. We see in your word the beauty of the gifts you've given in terms of marriage and childbearing and child rearing. And we see most of all your beauty in the gift of your Son, who makes all of these gifts possible to us sinners. And Father, we pray that as your people, we would gratefully relish your gifts, that we would, with an open hand and a grateful heart, receive from your hand and your heart the gifts that you have for us, and food and fellowship and marriage, and again, most of all, the person of your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Father, we thank you for him. We thank you that he is your greatest gift. And we pray that we would see every other gift of yours in light of him. That we would see every gift as a gift of your love and grace and kindness to us in him. Father, we confess that we aren't grateful as we should be. Instead of giving you thanks, we complain. Instead of loving you for your kindness, we moan and we grumble and we're anxious. Father, forgive us for our sin, for our ingratitude, and grant that we would leave this evening a grateful people. Grant that we would leave this evening having our eyes open to your goodness and all of your gifts to us. Father, grant that we very simply would just believe your word as it speaks of your grace and your goodness and your gifts. Father, grant that this evening would be used by you to further your purposes. Grant that we would leave this place changed, that we would leave this place more happy, more holy, more humble, loving you more and loving one another more, and more eager to serve you in the coming week. Grant that we would be able to continue meeting as we are this evening. Grant that the government would rule in such a way that we are free to gather and hear your word and preach the gospel. And grant that we would take every opportunity that is presented to us that we might serve you in serving our neighbours. So be with us this evening. Strengthen us where we are weak. Forgive us where we have sinned. Cleanse us where we need cleansing. And teach us. For truly in being taught by you, there is the greatest liberty. As your Son said so beautifully, you will know the truth and the truth will set you free. So grant that we would know the truth in greater measure, that we might know in greater measure the liberty that is ours in Christ and your goodness to us in him. In his name, amen. So before we turn to the text for this evening, we'll sing one more hymn. That hymn is hymn 426, Rock of Ages. Thank you. Wonderful. Well, if I could ask you to open your Bibles to the book of Proverbs, we're continuing our journey through the book of Proverbs and basically doing one chapter per evening. We may slow down a little bit later, but we're continuing on at that rate, and we are in chapter 5 this evening. Chapter 5 of Proverbs, a beautiful portion of text. Really beautiful. So I'll read the chapter and then we'll begin. Proverbs chapter 5, reading the whole chapter, verse 1 to 23. This is the word of the Lord. My son, be attentive to my wisdom, incline your ear to my understanding, that you may keep discretion, and your lips may guard knowledge. For the lips of a forbidden woman drip honey, and her speech is smoother than oil. But in the end, she is bitter as wormwood, sharp as a two-edged sword. Her feet go down to death. Her steps follow the path to Sheol. She does not ponder the path of life. Her ways wander, and she does not know it. And now, O sons, listen to me, and do not depart from the words of my mouth. Keep your way far from her, and do not go near the door of her house, lest you give your honor to others and your years to the merciless. Lest strangers take their fill of your strength and your labors go to the house of a foreigner, and at the end of your life you groan when your flesh and body are consumed and you say, how I hated discipline and my heart despised reproof. I did not listen to the voice of my teachers or incline my ear to my instructors. I am at the brink of utter ruin in the assembled congregation. Drink water from your own cistern, flowing water from your own well. Should your springs be scattered abroad, streams of water in the streets, let them be for yourself alone and not for strangers with you. Let your fountain be blessed and rejoice in the wife of your youth, a lovely deer, a graceful doe. Let her breasts fill you at all times with delight. Be intoxicated always in her love. Why should you be intoxicated, my son, with a forbidden woman and embrace the bosom of an adulteress? For a man's ways are before the eyes of the Lord, and he ponders all his paths. The iniquities of the wicked ensnare him, and he is held fast in the cords of his sin. He dies for lack of discipline, and because of his great folly, he is led astray. Grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of the Lord remains forever. Before we turn to the Lord in the text, let's turn to the Lord in prayer. Let's pray together. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for this evening. We thank you for this portion of your word that you have set before us as a meal. And we pray, Father, that we would feast this evening, that you would feed us as with fat and rich food. For that is what your word is. It is fat and rich food. It is a delight to our souls. And may it be a delight this evening. May we delight in your word. And may we go out and delight in all of the good gifts that you have given us. Father, you are so good to us. Every day you shower us with 1,000 gifts. And we're not conscious of it. We don't recognize it. And as a result, we aren't joyful. So make us joyful. May our lives be marked by pure joy, gratefully relishing all you have given us, in and through and because of the work of your Son. In his name we pray. Amen. So this evening we're touching on a subject that is a major subject in the book of Proverbs, and that subject is adultery. Solomon repeatedly warns us about a specific woman, namely the forbidden woman. He spoke of her in chapter 2, verse 16. So you'll be delivered from the forbidden woman. He speaks of her hair in chapter 5, the lips of a forbidden woman drip honey. And in only two chapters, he's going to speak of her again. And he'll say this of her. Think of this imagery. This is chapter 7, verse 26. Speaking of the forbidden woman, he says this. Many a victim has she laid low, and all her slain are a mighty throng. Now that should tell us something, shouldn't it? Right? The fact that Solomon over and over and over again warns us about the forbidden woman should tell us something, shouldn't it? Specifically, it should tell us that Solomon's experience is much like our experience. Time and time again, what is the sin that ruins men? Adultery. Time and time again. Solomon saw that in the words that I just quoted. He says what? All her slain are a mighty throng. Just think of that picture of this mighty throng. All her slain are a mighty throng. Solomon pictures a pile of slain bodies, right? So you go to the forbidden woman's house. Maybe you go down into her basement, and there it is. Just a pile of bodies. All her slain are a mighty throng. It's haunting imagery, but what makes it even more haunting is Solomon could have named men in that pile, right? Remember, Bible is not only inspired, it's also the product of human reflection on human experience. And so when Solomon talks about her slain being a mighty throng, he's talking at least in part about men that he could name. And so his experience is much like ours, because we know men in that pile too, don't we? Right? All of us can name men who ruined their lives with the forbidden woman. Sadly, some of us can name men who were pastors and elders who ruined their lives with the forbidden woman, whose bodies are in that pile, to use the language, to use the imagery that Solomon uses. But back to chapter 5. Forbidden woman is the subject here, and Solomon touches on three things. The forbidden woman, for the sake of alliteration, we'll call her the temptress. The teacher, Solomon speaks of teachers and instructors in verse 13. And then as he closes, he gets really practical and really explicit when he touches on the teaching, specifically what one should do to avoid the temptress. So that's what we'll be looking at this evening. So firstly, the temptress, verses 1 to 6. My son, be attentive to my wisdom. Incline your ear to my understanding, that you may keep discretion, and your lips may guard knowledge. For the lips of a forbidden woman drip honey, and her speech is smoother than oil, but in the end she is bitter as wormwood, sharp as a two-edged sword. Her feet go down to death. Her steps follow the path to Sheol. She does not ponder the path of life. Her ways wander. She does not know it. I don't know how many of you have heard of the book Dante's Inferno. If you've not heard of Dante's Inferno, Isaac and I are having to read it for a course that we're doing. But if you've not heard of it, it's a fictional book, Dante's Inferno, totally made up. But it's written about a man who travels through hell, the pilgrim Dante. Now, I wouldn't recommend it for its theology, Dante's Inferno. Wouldn't recommend it for its theology. Although there are some elements of it where you think that's really solid. But I would recommend it for its poetry, right? Some of the language in Inferno is just unbelievably beautiful. But the really interesting thing is that it's beautiful language in this book that's describing something that's really ugly, right? Because he's traveling through hell. He's seeing these ugly things, but he's describing it in beautiful language. It's really interesting. But the really interesting thing is, the really, really interesting thing is, the Bible's very similar in that sense. Time and time again, the Bible will use very beautiful language, poetry, to describe really ugly things. We see that here, Solomon, and not only Solomon, but God through Solomon says, the lips of a forbidden woman drip honey, and her speech is smoother than oil. Right? That's beautiful language. That's poetry. Not only that, though, it's beautiful language and beautiful poetry that, as it were, paints an enticing picture. Solomon's saying, her lips drip honey, the lips of a forbidden woman. Her speech is smooth. The way she talks, how she sounds, what she says, it's smoother than oil. Again, that's an enticing picture. But, and here's the kicker, he immediately follows it up by saying, sweet as her lips and speech may be, she's as bitter as wormwood and sharp as a two-edged sword. Her feet go down to death and her steps to shale. As we saw in the beginning, big pile of bodies in her basement. All her slain are a mighty throng. And as sweet as she appears initially, there are deep and deadly and disastrous consequences for following her. For adultery. So that's the forbidden woman. A stand-in for adultery, as it were. Now, before we move to the next setting, I do just want to draw out three things here. Firstly, there is never any excuse for going with this forbidden woman, ever. Full stop. You know, if the Bible did minimize the forbidden woman, if the Bible did minimize adultery, if the Bible did minimize her lure, you can imagine someone making the excuse, oh, God just doesn't really understand how tempted I was, right? God just doesn't really understand how tempting the forbidden woman is and how tempting adultery is. And that's complete nonsense. He says her lips drip honey. Her speech is smoother than oil. He knows how tempting she is. And yet that's no excuse. He doesn't say, therefore it's okay. Secondly, there are consequences for going with this forbidden woman. Always. Her feet always, not sometimes, always lead down to death. It's not that some men or some women get away with this. Sin always has consequences and will always find you out, and it always leads to death. Thirdly, there is one way of fighting such temptation, and we see here, and that way of fighting temptation that we see kind of hinted at here, but we'll pick up on this later as well. The way of fighting temptation here that we see hinted at is the way of beauty. In light of what we've seen in Proverbs and what we see elsewhere, what can we say about the Bible, right? I'm holding my iPad, but this is a stand-in for the Bible. What can we say about the Bible, about this book, about its nature? What can we say about it? It's beautiful. It's beautiful. This book that keeps us from sin is beautiful. Remember, it's the Bible that keeps us from sin. How can a young man keep his way pure, Psalm 119 asks? By guarding it according to your word. How is it that we're sanctified according to Jesus? We're sanctified by the truth. The word is truth. And this book, this truth that God gives us to sanctify us, to keep us from sin, we see that what? It's beautiful. It's not a boring text, in other words. The book that God gave us to keep us from sin, to sanctify us, isn't a maths book, right? It's not some boring book full of formulas. It's a beautiful book full of poetry and simile and metaphor. It's a wonderful book to read. And even when describing something ugly, it does so in a beautiful way. It can't help but be beautiful. So in this sort of paradoxical way, part of the method that God employs to keep us from the beautiful but forbidden woman is beauty. In other words, one of the ways to fight the temptation towards illegitimate beauty is legitimate beauty. And like I say, we'll pick up on that later. So just pigeonhole that for now. But that's the temptress, now the teacher, verses 7 to 14. And now, O sons, listen to me and do not depart from the words of my mouth. Keep your way far from her and do not go near the door of her house, lest you give your honor to others and your years to the merciless, lest strangers take their fill of your strength and your labors go to the house of a foreigner. And at the end of your life you groan when your flesh and body are consumed and you say, how I hated discipline. My heart despised reproof. I did not listen to the voice of my teachers or incline my ear to my instructors. I am at the brink of utter ruin. The assembled congregation. One of the most haunting stories that I've ever heard relating to
this topic, the forbidden woman, adultery, was the story of a reformed pastor who committed suicide. And after he committed suicide, it emerged that he had had multiple affairs with women in his congregation. And it's a haunting story, because that's not the behavior of someone who's regenerate. It's not. That's the behavior of someone who, to use the imagery from earlier, is in the pile of slain bodies in the basement of the forbidden woman's house. But when you hear a story like that, what's your reaction, right? When you hear that kind of story, you want to know how it happened, don't you? You want to, how does someone get to that place? Multiple affairs with multiple women in the congregation and then ending his own life. How does that happen? How do you get there? How does a professing believer, let alone a pastor, let alone a reformed pastor, end up in that situation and in that pile of bodies? How does it happen? Verses 12 to 14. These are the words of a man who's gone with the forbidden woman. Speaking from that pile, speaking from the grave. And he says, this is what went wrong. This is where I went wrong. He says, I hated discipline. He says, my heart despised reproof. He says, this is where we get the language of our second heading. He says, I didn't listen to the voice of my teachers. I didn't incline my ear to my instructors. And so now I am at the brink of utter ruin in the assembled congregation. What went wrong? This man tells us. He says, I didn't listen to my teachers. That's it. It's not that he'd heard God audibly in this amazing way and he ignored him. It's that he just didn't listen to his teachers. That's it. You know, this is so true to life, isn't it? How often do you see people commit big sin because they just refuse to listen to those around them? Whether it's adultery or some other sin, big sin begins where? Big sin begins with this thought. This thought, you ready? They just don't know what they're talking about. These people around me who are trying to tell me not to do this thing, they don't know what they're talking about. They just don't. They have no idea what they're talking about. So you've got an individual who's thinking they should go in this direction, who wants to go in this direction, who's justifying it to themselves. And those around them, their teachers, their instructors, their pastors, their parents, those who love them, are saying, don't do that. Please don't do that. Please don't do that. And the thought, like I say, in their heads is what? I don't know what they're talking about. They don't know my situation. They don't know what's going on. They're being judgmental. Things will work out. It'll be okay. And lo and behold, it turns out they did know what they were talking about. That happens over and over and over again. But by the time you realize that, it's too late and you're at the brink of utter ruin in the assembled congregation. And you see that time and time again, like I say. And so let me just say here, another way that you're kept from the forbidden woman is very simply by listening to those around you who love you and who want the best for you. Your teachers, your instructors, those who love you. It's pride that says they don't know what they're talking about. It's pride speaking. It's pride that refuses to listen to advice, and it's pride that leads where? To the fall. But here we come to our third heading, because Solomon goes from talking about teachers to actually giving some very practical teaching as it relates to the forbidden woman. And it's remarkable teaching, right? I said in the beginning that this is a beautiful section of Scripture. This is the portion I mainly had in mind, one of the most beautiful sections of Scripture. What I want to do is read it again, verses 15 to 23, and then just point a few things out. The teaching, verse 15, drink water from your own cistern, flowing water from your own well. Should your springs be scattered abroad, streams of water in the streets, let them be for yourself alone and not for strangers with you. Let your fountain be blessed and rejoice in the wife of your youth, a lovely deer, a graceful doe. Let her breast fill you at all times with delight. Be intoxicated always in her love. Why should you be intoxicated, my son, with a forbidden woman and embrace the bosom of an adulteress? For a man's ways are before the eyes of the Lord, and he ponders all his paths. The iniquities of the wicked ensnare him, and he is held fast in the cords of his sin. He dies for lack of discipline. And because of his great folly, he is led astray. Like I say, I just want to point a few things out. Firstly, notice how beautiful this is. And Solomon, in verse 18, Solomon speaks of one's wife. This is such beautiful language. He speaks of one's wife as the wife of your youth. Such beautiful imagery. Such a beautiful way of speaking of one's wife, right? There you are, you've been married 50 years, and Solomon points to your wife, and he calls her the wife of your youth. What's he doing here? He's kind of saying, remember when you guys were newlyweds, right? He's taking you back to the honeymoon phase. He says, the wife you had when you were newlywed, and then he follows it up. A lovely deer, a graceful doe. Again, this is beautiful language. You might be different to me. I think deer are beautiful. I do. Just beautiful animals. Does are beautiful. They are graceful. And that's the imagery that he uses here. Secondly, that's the first thing, how beautiful it is. Secondly, notice how lavish this is. This is this over-the-top lavish. He says, let her breasts fill you at all times with delight. All times. Not just some of the time. This is lavish. All of the time. Right? This clock should never stop running. All of the time. And he doesn't just say, you know, fill you up some of the way. He says all of the way. Fill you with delight. And then he follows up. And this is even more extreme. This is so extreme. You know that if religious people were in charge of putting the Bible together, this verse would not have made it in. Right? Listen to this. Be intoxicated always in her love. You know what the Hebrew literally means? I don't really like saying, you know, what the Hebrew says. You just sound all highfalutin and playing intellectual games. Trying to impress people. I know the original language. The Hebrew here means be led astray. Be led astray in her love. Solomon is saying be led astray in her love. Be intoxicated in her love. When you connect this to the language of Song of Songs, I mean, and again, it's just not going to hear many religious people were comfortable saying this. You could say, be drunk in her love, right? That's what Song of Songs says. I can hide behind Song of Songs when I say that. Be drunk in her love. Eat, friends, drink, and be drunk with love. That's Song of Songs. This is lavish. Thirdly, though, notice whose eyes he puts all of this before. This is so wonderful in context. Verse 21. For a man's ways are before the eyes of the Lord. This is so counterintuitive. Imagine with me, during marital counseling, say, right? And you say to a young couple, now, I want you to know that your whole life is lived before the eyes of the Lord, every single part. And you either say it explicitly, you're kind of implying, even your love life. It's all before the eyes of the Lord. Most people's instinct at that point would be to what? Right? Okay, every single part of my life is before the eyes of the Lord, including my love life. Okay, what should I do if the Lord is watching over that as well? I need to be restrained. Right, that's our natural instinct. Everything I do is before the eyes of the Lord, including my love life, my relationship with my spouse. If that's the case, then I need to be restrained. But in the context, what direction should we tend in? The opposite direction. This points us in the opposite direction. Solomon has just said in so many words, go for it. Be led astray in her love. Be intoxicated in her love. Be drunk in her love. Don't hold back. Let her breast fill you at all times with delight. It's the opposite direction from the place that our heart naturally inclines us towards at all times with delight. Fourthly, notice verse 23 in context. So we've looked at verse 21 in context, for a man's ways are before the eyes of the Lord. Notice verse 23 in context. Solomon says, he dies for lack of discipline, and because of his great folly, he is led astray. In the context of the whole chapter, what does it look like to lack discipline? In the context of the whole chapter, what does it look like to be led astray? Paradoxically, being led astray in verse 23 by the forbidden woman looks like a failure to be led astray by one's wife. That's the language that he used. Be led astray in her love. And again, paradoxically, a lack of discipline looks like what? It looks like a lack of delight in one's spouse. Now, it's here that we pick up on a theme from earlier. Remember I said earlier, we fight illegitimate beauty with legitimate beauty. That's really what Solomon is getting at here. You keep yourself from sin, from adultery, from illegitimate pleasure. How? Well, one way, according to Proverbs 5, is legitimate pleasure. Indulging oneself and recognizing that the gift you indulging yourself in is a gift from your heavenly Father. That's what Solomon says. That's his advice. That's his wisdom, I should say. That's what Solomon says. But it's not just Solomon who says this. Remember, the Bible has two authors, human author, divine author. It's the Father saying this. This is inspired. Again, some religious people might want to keep this out of the Bible, but this is inspired. The Father put this here. It's the Father who says, go for it. Be intoxicated in her love, in the love of the wife of your youth. And it's not just the Father. It's the Spirit and the Son who say, go for it. Be intoxicated in her love, in the love of the wife of your youth. And that brings us to the gospel as we close. This text reveals what? Right, not only the horror of adultery, but it reveals the unbelievably lavish and kind and generous and beautiful heart of God. That he would give us the gift of marriage and everything that goes with it and say, go for it, indulge, enjoy, take pleasure. But there's something that reveals the unbelievably lavish and kind and generous and beautiful heart of God even more than the gift of marriage is in there. And it's given to everyone who's a believer, whether they're married or single. And that's the gift of his Son, who for us, his people, his bride, endured pain that we might know eternal life and enjoy God and all the gifts he gives us every day. So as we close, let me just say this. If you have fallen in this area, in the area of adultery, let me just say that the death that you deserve to die, Jesus can take for you if you believe in him. Sin always leads to death, but for believers, what is true? He took that death for us. And if you do believe, he has already taken that death for you. There may be consequences in this life, but there are no eternal consequences whatsoever. If you're a believer, because that sin has been punished already. But if you don't want to fall, this is the solution, at least part of it. It's appreciating the kindness and goodness and beauty and grace of God wherever it is found, in marriage, in food, in friendship, fellowship, but most especially where? In the cross. Live there at the foot of the cross. Enjoy God and all of his good gifts. Stay humble as others teach you and instruct you. Obey his word and you'll be kept safe from the forbidden woman. Let's pray. Now, Heavenly Father, we pray that you would keep us all from sin. We pray that you would make us instead filled with joy, filled with happiness, filled with gratitude because of all of your good gifts to us. Food, friendship, marriage, fellowship, most especially the person of your Son. May we all see him more and more every day in all of his beauty, that we might have our hearts satisfied by him, by pure joy, pure delight in him, that we might be kept from sin and from seeking satisfaction anywhere else except at your right hand. For as your word says so beautifully, at your right hand are pleasures forevermore. May we all know these joys and pleasures that are found in you and you alone. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So we're going to close this evening with one final song. That song is hymn 898, All Glory Be to Christ. To him who was able to keep you from stumbling and to present you blameless before the presence of his glory with great joy, to the only God our Saviour through Jesus Christ our Lord, be glory, majesty, dominion and authority before all time and now and forever. Amen. Wonderful. So Tuesday night is on, Bible study is on as usual, next door at 7:30. If I don't see you there, I'll see you next week. Thank you.